Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, the Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. Before continuing, I want to thank Georgios for the new background and graphics for the Commander Tavern. They look amazing, and I hope you all enjoy them. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews and other deck techs. On this first episode of the third season of The Brewery, I will be discussing my take on a commander from Unsanctioned, Acornelia, Fashionable Filcher. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. Other ways you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. Patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, and higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to that down in the description too. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Acornelia is a 3-3 squirrel for 3 generic and 1 black. She seems like she belongs to Sneak, but she doesn't have the watermark. She has a bunch of interesting abilities, so let's go over them one at a time. Her first ability is an Art Matters ability, similar to those found on other silver bordered cards. Every time you cast a spell with a squirrel in its art, you get an acorn counter. This is similar to energy counters. You also get acorn counters whenever a squirrel enters the battlefield under your control or whenever a squirrel you control dies. This is great because not only can you get a bunch of acorn counters if you create a bunch of squirrel tokens, but you also get acorn counters when they die. The reason we want a lot of acorn counters is because of her two activated abilities. We can either pay 3 mana and X acorn counters to give a creature -X-X until end of turn, or pay 1 mana and X acorn counters to give a creature +X+X until end of turn. This might seem counterintuitive since the deck would seem to want to go wide, since creating a bunch of squirrel tokens gives acorn counters. However, if Acornelia is unblocked, you can pump her enough to kill someone via commander damage. You can also use acorn counters to kill off creatures. In this deck, however, that's a bit slow. Not that the ability is useless, but the acorn counters will be used mostly to pump our own creatures. And which creatures will we be pumping? Earl of Squirrel for one. This is single-handedly the best card in the deck. Not only does it pump squirrels, but it also makes your other creature tokens squirrels too. However, it's its squirrel link that makes it the best card in the deck. If you attack with it and use Acornelia to pump it, the damage it makes will create even more squirrel tokens, which in turn give you even more acorn counters than before. This is some insane interaction. It surprises me that Earl of Squirrel wasn't included in Unsanctioned, but that's a discussion for another video. Earl of Squirrel isn't the only squirrel creator in the deck though, it's just the best one. But the deck does include Deep Forest Hermit and Deranged Hermit. These create 4 squirrel tokens when entering the battlefield, but they also pump squirrels +1/+1. Deep Forest Hermit has Vanishing 3, so it won't be allowed for long, and Deranged Hermit has Echo. However, even with these two drawbacks, these cards are great for the deck. They have squirrels in their art, so they trigger Acornelia upon casting, and they create 4 squirrels which also trigger Acornelia. That means that you're essentially paying 5 mana for 5 acorn counters. Squirrel Wrangler and Liege of the Hollows also create squirrel tokens, but at the cost of destroying something. Since they have squirrels in their art, they also trigger Acornelia upon casting. The Wrangler can create 2 squirrel tokens at the cost of 2 mana and sacrificing a land. It can also be used to pump all squirrels +1/+1 for the same cost, but is primarily used for creating squirrel tokens. Sacrificing a land isn't a big deal in this deck, but we'll see why later on. Liege of Hollows creates squirrel tokens upon dying if you pay mana for it. For each mana you pay, you create a squirrel token. Unfortunately, opponents can do the same, but they won't be able to take advantage of it as we can. This is also another way to exchange mana for acorn counters in a 1-to-1 ratio. Acorn Harvest and Chatter of the Squirrel are easy and quick ways to get acorn counters with Acornelia. Each trigger her upon casting and then again when the squirrel tokens enter the battlefield. Both spells have flashback, so you can get even more triggers out of them. However, the best reusable ways of getting squirrel tokens is with Acorn Catapult, Druid's Call, and Squirrel Nest. Unfortunately, only the latter two spells trigger Acornelia when cast, since Acorn Catapult doesn't have a squirrel in its art. Squirrel Nest is the easiest one since all you have to do is tap down the enchanted land to create a squirrel token. This goes infinite with Earthcraft, but I'll discuss that combo later on. Acorn Catapult can also tap down to create a squirrel token, but you need to pay 1 mana to do so. If you target an opponent or any of their creatures, they get the token. But if you target yourself or one of your own creatures, you get the token. If you ping your own squirrel tokens, you're basically replacing them and getting 2 acorn counters for your troubles. Or, you can also ping a creature enchanted by Druid's Call. Whenever enchanted creature receives damage, you create squirrel tokens. This is a great deterrent against attacks, so you can just chump block with the enchanted creature to create a bunch of tokens. Another way to create squirrel tokens is by multiplying them. Doubling Season, Primal Vigor, and Parallel Lives do just that. Any tokens that you would create are duplicated. Be careful with Primal Vigor though, since this also helps out opponents. Having these out might seem win more, but the fact remains that squirrels isn't as supported as goblins or soldiers, so we have to maximize our squirrel population as much as possible. We can also double the squirrels we already have in play with Second Harvest. This spell doubles the tokens we already have on the battlefield. With enough squirrel tokens in play, casting this will make Acornelia give us a ton more acorn counters. There are ways of bypassing that lack of squirrels and still trigger Acornelia. Conspiracy makes it so that all of our creatures are squirrels, so those creatures without squirrels in their art might not trigger her, but they will when they enter the battlefield. They'll also gain the boons given by Earl of Squirrel, Deranged Hermit, and Deep Forest Hermit. Panharmonicon can also double Acornelia's effect by duplicating the effect of her Enter the Battlefield trigger. So instead of getting one acorn counter when a squirrel enters the battlefield, we get two instead. It also duplicates the Enter the Battlefield triggers of other creatures in the deck besides the aforementioned Elf Hermits. Equipping Acornelia with Helm of the Host is also another way to double her triggered effects. Thanks to Second Harvest, you can also duplicate those tokens as well. Helm of the Host might be a great way to copy her triggered abilities, but Illusionist's Bracers is a great way to copy her activated abilities. Alright, so now that we have our squirrel army and a huge acorn stash, what now? Well, time to go wide. Metallic Mimic and Oran Reef the Vastwood can put +1/+1 counters on those squirrels entering the battlefield. Metallic Mimic also triggers Acornelia, so that's a plus. Karn's Bastion and Evolution Sage help in proliferating those +1/+1 counters on creatures. Not only that, but they can also be used to proliferate other counters such as acorns and the other counters in the deck. That I'll be discussing soon enough. Coat of Arms is also a great artifact in the deck. The pump your creatures get is insane. But, as with Primal Vigor, be careful since the effect is symmetrical and you might help out opposing tribal decks. Craterhoof Behemoth is included in the deck for similar reasons. This alone is a viable win con since it could make creatures insanely large while also giving them trample. With enough squirrels on the battlefield, you can just alpha strike the whole table to win the match. However, the best way to pump creatures in the deck is with Mazurk Kral Death Priest. Every time anyone sacrifices anything, we put a +1/+1 counter on all of our creatures. If you're wondering why it's included in the deck, it's because I take advantage of the squirrels not just for Acornelia's sake, but to also synergize with all the engines in the deck. Keep in mind that Acornelia also triggers when squirrels die, so let's see what we can accomplish with the squirrel fodder. Card draw is one main way to do so. Yawgmoth Thran Physician and Erebos Bleak-Hearted have built-in sacrifice outlets that can achieve other effects besides drawing cards. Both can potentially get rid of creatures by giving them negative toughness. However, both can also draw cards off of their ability. We might have to pay life in the process, but that's not really a problem in the deck. We might have to pay 2 mana to activate Erebos' sacrifice outlet, but at least it's free to draw a card when a creature dies. We just have to pay 2 life each time. Losing life isn't a problem thanks to Moldervine Reclamation. This enchantment basically helps nullify Yawgmoth's life cost. We pay 1 life, sacrifice a creature, but then we get to draw 2 cards and then regain that life. As a bonus, we give a creature -1/-1 in the process. Dark Prophecy is another enchantment where we draw cards off of our creatures dying. Unfortunately, in order to cost 2 less, it costs triple black and we lose a life instead of gaining it like Moldervine Reclamation. It's still good because it's free card draw and we never want to run out of steam in a multiplayer commander game. Liliana Dreadhorde General will also draw us a card for our creatures dying, and that's just her static ability. Her other loyalty abilities are relevant in the deck. Her first loyalty ability gives us a sacrifice fodder. Her second loyalty ability is a sacrifice outlet that also disrupts opponents because everyone has to sacrifice 2 creatures. Her ultimate isn't the main reason for running her, but if you can achieve it, go for it. What's great about these cards is that they only care about our creatures dying, not how they died. Smothering Abomination cares about how creatures died though. If the creature was sacrificed, then we draw a card. Its sacrifice outlet isn't activated like Yawgmoth and Erebos, but at least it does have a triggered effect at the beginning of our upkeep, so we're still able to sacrifice creatures with it somewhat. Skull Clamp is another great way to draw cards in the deck. If the squirrels are pumped by some effect, we might not draw the cards immediately upon Skull Clamp getting equipped, but when we sacrifice that creature, we'll get to draw the 2 cards from it dying. Another great free sacrifice outlet is Viscera Seer. It might not be card draw like the previous cards, but it helps filter our draw. It only costs 1 to cast, and if we resolve its ability first, we might scry away a card before we draw it. That way we at least have some control over what's drawn. Necropotence is also included in the deck. It might cost triple black like Dark Prophecy, but it's viable in a 2-colored deck. Drawing a card at the cost of 1 life is crazy good in games where you start at 40 life. Also, since we're not actually drawing a card, this bypasses effects that don't allow you to draw cards or draw more than 1 card at a time, so it laughs in the face of Narset, Parter of Veils. We can also capitalize on the amount of tokens being killed for value by turning them into mana. Ashnit's Altar and Phyrexian Altar transform squirrels into mana. Not only do we get mana, but we trigger anything that cares about creatures dying and or being sacrificed. These altars are a no-brainer since we want to be able to have mana to cast all those cards we're drawing into. Speaking of which, Black Market is another way to capitalize on creatures dying. What's great about Black Market is that it's not restricted to only our creatures. It triggers when any creature dies, including our opponents. And that's what's important since this deck is also getting rid of opponents' creatures. So with the solid engine going, we can go off fairly quickly and easily while also disrupting the table. Remember, it's not just about going off, but going off while also burying our opponents. Earthcraft and Cryptolith Rite also turn bodies into mana, no pun intended. Cryptolith Rite basically turns our creatures into Birds of Paradise. With enough creatures in play, we can very easily reach turn 10 in turn 3 or 4. Earthcraft lets our creatures untap basic lands. As I mentioned earlier, this goes infinite with Squirrel Farm. What you do is enchant a basic land with Squirrel Farm. Afterwards, you tap it to create the squirrel. Then you tap the squirrel to untap the enchanted land. Rinse and repeat. Thanks to this, you get infinite squirrel tokens as well as infinite acorn counters if Acornelia is on the battlefield. Gaia's Cradle takes advantage of all the creatures to generate an insane amount of mana. It might not work if your field is free of creatures, but at least Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth can make it tap for black. Speaking of which, Cabal Coffers is also in the deck to really send the message home of how much mana this deck can generate. Having so many different ways of generating mana is important, which is why the deck does run conventional ways of accelerating mana like ramp spells. Farseek, Three Visits, and Nature's Lore are the trifecta of ramping in decks running green. Each of these can get a dual-type land and only cost 2 mana. Three Visits and Nature's Lore don't put the land into play tapped, so that's always a plus. In this deck, I chose Soul Ring over Mana Crypt as the mana rock because we're losing so much life from other sources that getting unlucky with Mana Crypt might actually kill us, so paying 1 extra for the casting cost is negligible in this case. I have mentioned going off while also hindering our opponents, and that's because our engines can achieve both things simultaneously. Not only can we sacrifice things for value, but to our opponent's dismay as well. Attrition can let us snipe non-black creatures by pitching fodder to it and paying 1 black mana. However, in this deck, you know I have to add Grave Pact and Dictate of Erebos. The moment we have enough squirrels to sacrifice and prevent our opponents from keeping any creatures means that we can swing in uncontested. Not only that, but besides not having any blockers, they won't have any utility creatures, beaters, etc. We can also kill opponents without entering combat, thanks to Zulaport, Cutthroat, and Sir Conrad the Grim. So many creatures dying will trigger these effects enough times to really make a difference, potentially in a game-ending turn. Zulaport, Cutthroat also gains us 1 life, which is great to balance out the effects that cost us life. However, if we really want to drain the table, and potentially win off of it, we can sink all the mana we generate into a game-ending exsanguinate. Why just gain life when you can gain it at the expense of opponents? Besides, there's no greater removal than player removal. Well, maybe multiple player removal. Speaking of removal, Beast Within, Assassin's Trophy, and Scour from Existence can straight up get rid of anything on the battlefield at instant speed. It's always good to have some silver bullets in case our engines aren't online. Force of Vigor is also included because enchantments and artifacts can be quite problematic, especially against Horde Aristocrat decks like this one. Naturally, the deck's running Kindred Dominance. I highly doubt our opponents are running Squirrels, so naming Squirrel when you cast it will more than likely be a one-sided war wipe. If we have Conspiracy out, then we also get to keep our non-squirrel creatures because they're now squirrels. However, if we do lose some of our creatures, that's not a big problem. The deck's running ways of recovering cards as well as reanimating creatures. Whisper Blood Liturgist capitalizes on the Aristocrats aspect of the deck by sacrificing 2 measly tokens in exchange for an important creature from the graveyard. The best way to use Whisper is with Deranged Hermit. Don't pay for its echo cost and just sacrifice 2 of the squirrels it created to reanimate it from the graveyard. Marin of Clan Nelthoth also takes advantage of death and reanimation. Whenever a creature we control dies, we get an experience counter. With all the induced deaths and sacrifices, we can get quite the amount of experience counters. Counters that can be proliferated, as I mentioned earlier too. Thanks to that, we can reanimate a creature for free at the beginning of our end step. Besides creatures, we can also reanimate lands with Ramanop Excavator. This deck's running all 8 fetch lands not just to fix mana and thin the deck of lands, but to also trigger cards like the previously mentioned Mazurek, Kral Death Priest, and Evolution Sage. You can also recover lands sacrificed to Squirrel Wrangler as mentioned near the beginning of the video. So this is definitely an amazing cog in multiple engines in the deck. Eternal Witness might not reanimate anything, but it does return a card to our hand. Being an Enter the Battlefield ability is great in this deck because we can reuse it so easily by sacrificing and reanimating it later. So it will definitely pull its weight by potentially recovering plenty of cards in a single game. We can also exploit these abilities with Temur Sabertooth. Not only can we bounce creatures to protect them, but if we bounce creatures with squirrels in their art, we can trigger Acornelia when we cast them later on. As a bonus, it gets indestructible. With enough mana, we can use it to protect our non-token creatures from board wipes by bouncing everything back to our hand while it remains indestructible on the battlefield. Now that I mentioned protection, the deck's also running Swiftfoot Boots, Lightning Greaves, and Whisper Soul Cloak. Not that the deck can't function without Acornelia in play, but they're great at protecting prime targets for removal like Merrin, Mazarek, Sir Conrad, Whisper, etc. Also, Lightning Greaves gives haste for free. If we want to tap down new creatures thanks to Cryptolith Rite, we can equip Lightning Greaves to them and then tap them for mana the same turn they enter the battlefield. In any case, the deck has Swarm Yard to save Acornelia and Mazarek too from lethal damage and destruction effects without the Can Be Regenerated clause. It doesn't enter the battlefield tapped and can be used to generate mana as well. Definitely a must include for this deck. Before listing the non-utility lands in the deck, I want to highlight two particular token creators in the deck, Avenger of Zendikar and Grismold the Dread Soa. Even though the tokens they create aren't squirrels, it doesn't matter because either Earl of Squirrel or Conspiracy will change them into squirrels. The reason they're included is because of the synergy they have in the deck. The Avenger can be bounced with Temur Sabertooth or constantly sacrificed then reanimated for even more value. Also, since the deck is ramping and fetching lands as well as playing them from the graveyard, it's also possible to amass a huge army of huge plant tokens, especially since we're also proliferating in the deck. So these plants can be used for everything from attacking to chump blocking to sacrifice fodder to converted squirrels. Same goes for Grismold. He creates plant tokens, albeit for everyone. However, whenever a token creature dies, he gets a +1/+1 counter, and he has trample. So not only is he a good way of getting tokens onto the battlefield, but he can also be a huge beater, especially one that Acornelia can pump with acorn counters in order to eliminate a player. Even if those players have any plant tokens created by Grismold, they're going to die to all the stax effects in the deck. The rest of the cards in the deck are just the lands. Command Tower, Bayou, Overgrown Tomb, Llanowar Waste, Nurturing Peatland, Ancient Tomb, and Temple of the False God, as well as 8 of each basic land. Recall also that the deck is running all 8 fetch lands. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Acornelia Fashionable Filcher. This deck is chocked full of synergy and engines that can really take over the game pretty quickly, whether it be assembling a huge army to swing wide or pump a creature so huge it one-shots a hapless opponent. You can also keep the board clear of creatures except for yours. There's just tons of different ways to assemble engines that can do all sorts of things, so this deck is a lot of fun to pilot and play. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of the Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am Demented Kirby, and happy brewing!